Manager to allow me to talk about this particular problem here. So I will talk about basically numerical simulation of a Joseph Junction Array model or model weak links, motivated by experimental results on the superconducting insulating transition in unholy thin films with bonding flux disorder. Let's see if I go this thing here. No. So I will basically give you the motivation why I start this work based on this experiment, then tell you about the model, and then present the multicolor simulations, including disorder, in both in the classical and in the quantum regime. So the motivation comes from this experiment on this system here, which is this is a template used to make to deposit the film. When you deposit the film, it takes the form of this hole here, and you can study the system here, drive through the superconducting insulating transition by changing the thickness. As you decrease the thickness, you see there are samples which become insulator, and samples which are thicker become superconductor. There is a separation of a resistance here, which is a valve of the resistance, which corresponds to the superconducting insulating transition. Right? And in the insulating side, near the superconducting insulating transition here, when you look at resistivity, you see that resistivity oscillates as a function of the magnetic field. You have this magneto-resistant oscillation, which the amplitude increases as you decrease the temperature. It turns out that this resistivity here is thermal activated because you are in the insulating phase. And then when you measure the activation energy, you see that the activation energy here decreases as you go through the, as we increase the thickness toward the superconducting insulating transition. And this is for F equal to zero. This is for F equal to 1/2. F here is the number of flux quanta per cell of the system here. Now, it's not that surprised that you get this oscillation here. The previous speaker already told us that this in rings, you have this thing here. But you can see there is what you see here is very similar to this cusps that he was mentioning here. And the one reason is that you can imagine that this thing here is actually a multi-connected weak link array, right? So that was basically what I consider, which was the case. So he basically gave us now a lot of justification that having the rings here connect this arm, there are many places for weak links. Although this is not a Josephson junction array in itself, you can use the Josephson junction array as a model and to see to which extent this actually expands the system. What attracted me the attention of this system here was the fact that when you look at these oscillations here, if you model this as an array, you would expect, besides this minima at the integer value of flux quantum, you'd expect a minima, a local minima at a third, because these holes are on a triangle lattice, and this when the flux is 1/3, you should get some commensurate values of the frustration here. And I would also expect that this exponent that measure how the activation energy vanishes here should be smaller than 1, although what you see here, that is certainly around 1 or greater than 1. And now, recently, there are some intriguing results which were obtained in the same system, which is another reason why it seems that the model that they're going to present here seem to be a reasonable model for this system, is that they made samples in which the holes now are randomly located. And then they found that if you have different samples with different amount of randomness here, these oscillations now as a function of the frustration or the number of flux quantum per packet now, the amplitude decreases, and the point at which this oscillation disappear is a decreasing function of the disorder. So the delta A here is the distribution of the areas of this plaquette here. So this one is more random, and the width is larger, and you see that the critical field, let's say, for where this oscillation disappears is smaller. So there is an effective disorder in the system, which is a combination of this geometrical disorder of the position of the grains in the magnetic field itself, which is this average F here. They also found that if you look at this magnetoresistance oscillation for different values of the at different temperatures, which are this color here, blue, green, and red, the point which they cross here is a point which corresponds to a field-induced superconducting insulator transition. So if you take each one of these points here and plot, you get this behavior here. So the resistance at this field, this successive field-induced superconducting insulator transition is not a constant, as you'd expect for a superconducting insulator transition, but actually changes as a function of the disorder, and changes quite significantly by a factor of almost 2. And the point or the value of the field in which this oscillation disappears is about 0.3, where delta Fc is a product of the average frustration time is the area, the time is the randomness in the area of this triangulation here, which was used to determine what is the area of these effective plaquettes. So I will then present you now a model, which is basically on just a junction arrays, as a minimum model for this system, which appears to give results which are consistent with the experiment. So the model is basically a model in which you consider that the holes of the arrays are the dual lattice of this black dots here, which are the local superconducting grains. And there are weak links between them, which is the Josephson junction coupling between them here. So there are two contributions. One contribution, which is the coupling between the grains, which has the usual phase difference, the vector potential, which is the, there are two terms for the vector potential here. I will explain here. And there is this term here, which has to do with the charging the grain, which give rise to this superconducting insulator transition. So this is a minimal model, so I only consider here the charging energy due to the capacitance to the ground. You could make it more complicated, but then there is difficulty doing the simulation. So this vector potential here, which is the sum of both, so here has two contributions. One contribution, which is the average field, right? Because this is a perfect array, but I allow for the flux on each one of this cell here to be different, to represent the model. So there are two contributions. One is from the uniform frustration, and the other, which is due to the randomness. So this randomness here now is based on the deviation of the flux from the average, right? So the sum of the Tij around a cell is equal to 2 pi f times delta fp. So then, since it is the deviation from the average flux, you immediately see that this deviation for the average flux is then equal to the external field average frustration times the randomness in the area. So then you immediately see that the effective frustration, this problem, delta F here, is the average frustration times the randomness in the area. So if you can, in the sample, in the system, you can either change samples by change delta DA, or then changing the average frustration. As you see here, the other point that you should note, I'm going to spend some time. I can't see the. Sorry if I have some difficulty seeing. This is a honeycomb lattice by what I just explained. The dual lattice here represent the hole. So, if it's a minimal model, you'd say, well, why not take a square lattice? But then you don't have the right geometry. And I'm going to show you here that this might not be important if the average frustration is zero. Is an integer number, but when the average frustration is a no integer number, then the geometry here is important. So to see this more clear, you can look at the, you can compare what would happen, for example, for f 1/2 when you have 1/2 flux per packet, which corresponds to a density of vortex 1/2 in a square. And in this honeycomb lattice. In the square lattice, because the square lattice is bipartite, you can, and the vortex wants to be far apart, you can you have a commensurate state which is double degenerate. And then And then even if you don't have the charging energy, which is here, well, if you set the charge energy equal zero, this model is basically the frustrated XY model. So in the classical limit, you then get a ground state, which is double degenerate, and you expect this thing has a phase transition as a function of temperature at some temperature, which turns out to be a combination of an Eisen transition and a KT transition. The Eisen is because you have the double degenerates. But if you go to the honeycomb lattice, you see that because the centers are now not triangular, you have a frustration. You have a geometrical frustration. And this geometrical frustration leads to a high degenerate ground state, which is microscopic degenerate. And there is no, in this case here, you don't even know actually, there is a question if it is actually has a transition as a function of temperature in absence of charging energy, in absence of quantum fluctuation. In fact, there are different results. Other results suggest there is a transition of KT type. Others suggest there is a spin glass transition. There's a possibility of an order phase, although you need a very large system at finite temperature despite this high degeneration. And there is also my own work that suggests that there is no transition as a function of temperature in this system, and there is a transition only at zero temperature. And if you now consider a third, you can get a perfect commensurate phase, which is threefold degenerate, and then you expect that, in this case, here's a function of temperature in absence of quantum fluctuation, you would have a transition which is a mixture of KT transition, costly Stahl's transition, and the three-state Potts model. So this is a calculation that I performed for the resistivity as a function of temperature in the case in which the charging energy is zero, so there is no quantum fluctuation. This calculation was done with this driven Monte Carlo dynamics, and then you can see here that I also allow for some disorder in the coupling, which I call bond disorder here. But if the disorder is zero, you see that for f equal to zero, for average number of flux, which is an integer, then zero, you get a transition. The resistivity goes to zero at some point, which is the transition for the system. After one-third, you also have a transition. But at one-half, you see, there is no transition. It's pure Arrhenius behavior, so the transition only happens at zero temperature. As you increase the disorder in the bonds, in the coupling here, then this transition remains because it's quite robust. But the transition at one-third then actually tend to disappear. And the one at one-half already was not there. So then if you allow for bond disorder or disorder in the Josephson coupling, you wash out this secondary minima that was expected to occur in the system. So that might be the reason why you don't actually see this one-third minima in the magneto's resistance, because there are bond disorder in the system. So, but now, although there is no transition at finite temperature, now I want to look at what happened as a function of, at zero temperature as a function of charging energy. And so I perform, and so then I want to look at the superconducting insulated transition. This is just a little summary. The superconducting insulated transition at zero temperature is due to this competition between phase and the charge in each grain, because these are canonical conjugate, quantum mechanical canonical conjugate. So if the phase, in the phase coherence phase, the phase is well defined. In the phase incoherence phase, what is well defined is the number, the charge in each grain. And then because of this, in the insulating phase, you have a gap. So as a function of the ratio of the charging energy to the Josephson coupling, there is a transition at some point. If the transition is second order, then the phase stiffness vanishes as you approach the transition from below. The gap in the insulated phase vanishes as you approach the transition from above. And right at the transition, the conductivity has this scaling form here, which it turns out that when d is equal to 2, which is the case I'm considering is a film, is a finite number, right? And it has been argued by Fischer, Gristin, and the others that this value of the conductivity is universal, depending only on the universality class of the transition. So if it's so, this quantity can be calculated by Monte Carlo simulation, and that's what I'm going to do. So some results are now kind of analytic and numeric only for the square lattice. So for the square lattice, this conductivity at the transition when the frustration is zero or is an integer number is now, when it's 1.5, there is also some calculations and some analytical result previously. But you see that because f and 1.5 are in different universal class, as I just showed, this is double degenerate, the value of the conductivity is actually quite different. It's almost a factor of 2. And there are some experimental comparison which was done in the past. But for the honeycombing lattice, which is our case, it has not not much has been done. So I then performed Monte Carlo simulations to determine the property of this transition using this path integral Monte Carlo simulation. So the gap in the oscillating phase is given by the inverse of the correlation length. And the way you do it is that the quantum mechanical problem in two dimensions becomes a classical problem in three dimensions, 1 plus 2 plus 1, where the extra dimension that you add here is the time direction, imaginary time direction. The ground state of the system is related to the free energy of this classical problem. So the first thing to do is to actually see what is, if there is actual transition for 1/2, and what's the nature of the transition for this small rational value. So I then look at, since I don't know the answer, so you get from the computer, and that's the simulation, and quite nicely, some kind of surprising result that when you look at the free energy barrier by, you know, doing this technique of the histogram technique, you find that when the frustration is a third, you have the free energy has this double minimum structure here, which is an indication that the transition is first order. So the transition is first order for a third, for 1/3, but for 1/2, you see there's two minima here. There is no energy barrier and the transition second order. That's quite different from what happened on the square lattice, in which case the F 1/3 is actually second order for both of case. So the transition at 1/2 is continuous, and then you can go and determine the critical exponents. That's you know, you look at the phase stiffness, and you look do some finite scaling calculations where there is a point which they cross, and you require that satisfied this scaling relation, you can determine the critical exponent and the critical coupling where the transition happened. Then you find that the critical exponent for 1/2 is this number here, and for f equal to 0 as a check, you find that is exactly what you expect for the case in which there is no frustration. You get the same result as you get for the square lattice, because when f equal to 0 or there is no frustration, then the details of the lattice doesn't matter, is the critical behavior is the same. And you can also calculate the conductivity at the transition. This is a calculation of the conductivity using this, I won't go in much detail. You have to do a finite size scaling. You have to explore the scaling, the frequency, and the finite size scaling by changing the system size. And you plot this quantity here, which is determined by the phase stiffness, and you extract the conductivity by doing this scaling relation here. The point, so these are curves for different system size and different frequency. The point in which it crosses the dotted line is an estimate of the conductivity. So for 1/2, you find this value here that's quite different, completely different from what you get for the square lattice. For f equal to 0, you get the right result. This is the result you get for the square lattice, which you actually show what you expect. The superconducting slate transition, the conductivity is a property of the fixed point. So if it's square lattice or honeycomb lattice, doesn't matter. But when you have frustration, it does matter. You get a factor between the conductivity is a factor of 4, in which the square lattice was a factor of 2. And you can also calculate what's the critical coupling as a function of the frustration. And you see here, so you find there is a little maxima at a third, which corresponded to in the gap should correspond to a local minima at a third. That's so you would expect that for the energy gap, for the activation energy for the system, you should get this a third here, right? And for the square lattice, you get this local minima at a 1/2, as you would expect. So if you compare with the experimental thing, you get this oscillation, but you don't get the minimum at this local minima at a third. Also, the way this vanishes is you get an exponent that is somehow higher than you expect theoretically, which means that the calculation, as was done without considering this order, doesn't have enough, it doesn't have all the ingredients, then you allow for effects of disorder in the form of bone disorder, and then you recalculate it, and then you see that now if you allow for bone disorder, the critical coupling now loses this local maxima, which in the energy gap would be a local minima at a third, so this is more compatible with the experimental situation. So there is some sort of bone disorder in the system which is significant because you don't have this local minimum. Also, the other interesting thing is that the transition at one third, which was first order, as we increase the bone disorder, it becomes second order, which is quite nice because this is consistent with a theorem which says that there is in presence of disorder, a first order transition is rounded, so it becomes second order. And then this is a little table in which I put all the numbers in presence of disorder. Now, if allowing for disorder, this is exponent now is around 1, which is consistent with the experimental result. So now I do the calculation allowing for allowing for flux disorder. So then the calculation has to allow for this extra term here, which is due to the disorder in the fluxes. Then I assume some distribution. Do the calculation, then what you get now is that at the integer value of frustration, the critical coupling decreases, while the critical coupling for non-integer frustration increases, and they actually merge at some critical value. This critical value which they merge, turns out you can show that it corresponds to a transition to a vortex glass state. So this point here is a point in which you change, you lose oscillation. You see, this is the gap. And it's no longer periodic. You have this activation energy decrease at some critical value, which is the value which is emerged here. So this is consistent with the experiment. And then when also calculated the conductivity at transition, the resistivity is plotted here. So for integer value, the resistivity decreases, and for no integer frustration, it increases. And when you compare with the experimental, this increase is actually quite, well, reasonable, consistent with the experimental value. And the critical value where the two lines merge, which is the transition to the vortex glass state, where you lose the oscillation, is roughly the same as you get experimentally. So in conclusion, the phase diagram you expect for this system here will depend if you have an integer value of flux per packet, or if you have a non-integer value. They differ in the basically when the disorder, effective disorder is small, but at a large disorder they have the same behavior. So this may, you may wonder then if what happened if you choose a slightly different model, because all this calculation was done with the flux being uncorrelated. But you can also define a model which is called gauge glass in which you have disorder in this Tij which correspond to disorder which is correlated in the flux. And then, but you'd expect that for large disorder, they give the same number. And actually, as shown here, the result is roughly the same. I also add a calculation here for a model called phase glass, but I have no time to discuss here. Then I will this is conclusion. So this simple model is a kind of minimal model, although it's not a complete model. It does describe some features that have been found recently, and that's basically what I want to say.
Okay, thank you very much. We have maybe possibility for one question.